I welcome you all on this wonderful evening. It is indeed a glorious evening for us as we get to meet and have a heart-to-heart with an eminent personality today. I feel honored to introduce to you this evening Ms. Arnabi Marjit, Head of Human Resources at Lupin Limited. She is responsible for employee life cycle for entire research and development as well as biotech for Lupin. She is an important part of senior management team for Lupin. But that's not all. She is also the chairperson of Prevention of Sexual Harassment Committee for the company.
Good evening. I was told that you've been sitting here and I think you've been having classes from 8 a.m. in the morning. Okay. So that's really scary, you know, just to hear that we have a room full of young boys and girls who are raring to go back to their hostels and crash on their beds. Yeah. And to top it all, you know, the other thing that I'm always worried about when I'm speaking to this generation is, what can I share that Google can't? Right? I'm sure all of you can go and Google it today, how to be successful in the corporate world, and you're going to get at least a million hits. Yes or no? So it's very difficult to come and speak and share something which Google doesn't have. But don't worry, I don't have a presentation with me because I know it's going to be death by presentation. You already must have seen so many presentations through the day today. I simply thought that through my, say, 20 plus years of career across various organizations, I just wanted to share a few of the success mantras, you know. And again, it's not all pervasive. So if it has worked for me, it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to work for everybody else. But I just thought that this is something I've learned the hard way. So if I could share with you, maybe it's just going to be useful for you all at this juncture of your career when you've just about stepped in. I was told you're just 1 month old, right? So that's all I thought I'll do. So I'll hardly take a short while to take you through some of the points that I've jotted down. And after which I would really love it if this can be an interactive session. If you could ask me questions, or if you're too tired, then, you know, let that be. Is that fine? Okay. So, say, this is your first month. You would be taking, what, 1.5 years for you to complete your course, post which there's going to be some summer internship, right? That's the format. Yes? So 1.5, 2 years from now, you would be stepping into, and typically it's in the month of March, April, May. That's when people join organizations. How many of you are experienced here? Anybody here who has experience? Okay, so quite a few of you. So some of you have already been through this. For those of you who've not been through it, when you will be walking into an organization, what we say is whatever you've earned in terms of your qualification, your scores, you know, just now I think Rona came in and presented the flowers and he's just stood first today, right? Where is he? Great. So there would be somebody like you who's going to be naturally topping the badge and subject by subject. At the end of it, when you enter an organization, it is that marks that you get or whatever rank you get or whatever you've earned for the last 2 years is just going to be nothing but a passport to enter that organization. It's just a gate pass, right? Once you're in, it doesn't matter where you come from, it doesn't matter which institute, what marks, what did you do in your 10th and what have you done in your plus two, nobody really gives a damn. Right? End of the day, all that matters is you today belong to this organization and what can you deliver here? That's about it. Okay? It doesn't matter beyond that. So the first thing that any organization expects is once you walk in, you have a sense of accountability. You have a sense of saying that, yes, from today onwards, as long as I'm there in this organization, I understand that those days are gone when people would join and retire from the same organization. I mean, who are we fooling? I mean, that's no longer valid. It's no longer real anymore. There was a time when we would say that somebody has worked for so many years in an organization Today, people say that I have 10 years of experience across 5 organizations, and people take pride in it. So that's about fine. That's there's no problem today on that. But while you are in an organization, you're naturally expected to deliver. You're expected to add value as long as you're there, till the last day that you're there. So therefore, all that the company expects that you show some ownership and accountability. And you don't start by saying, this is not my job. Okay. So when I say it's not my job is, you enter from a B school, reputed B school, you say a marketing postgrad, or you're a finance or an HR postgrad. And it may so be that in the first week or the first month, and I'm sure a lot of you who've already worked in companies have experienced this, you may be asked to simply populate an Excel sheet or go and create a file or just deliver something to somebody. Yes or no? Yeah, so that's real, you know. So if somebody says that, you don't start by saying that's not my job. I'm a B-school grad. I've been, I've studied a lot. I've come this far. Now you don't expect me to create these rubbish Excel sheets. I'm interested in strategy. Okay. Believe it or not, that's how a lot of people start off. And that's how you fail. Because if you start day one saying, I only want to work on strategy and I don't like transactional stuff, I don't like, do you know these words? You'll get to know very soon, you know. That's one big part of B-school education is you learn big words. So I don't want tactical stuff, I don't want transactional stuff. I want to deal with strategic stuff. It will all come in due course, but day one, do not start by saying, this is not my job, I'm only interested in strategy and I'm not interested in anything else. If you do, then nobody would actually give you enough for you to learn to get to a point when you can actually work on strategy. Yeah. So what was the first one? Never say this is not my job. Is that simple? Yes? Are you all awake?
Yes, ma'am.
Fantastic. Okay. Believe it or not, I'm not generally late for anything. This is really unlike me. I'm really sorry for today. But one very, very important thing is valuing each other's time. Okay, so maybe it sounds a bit odd because I've made you sit for 30 extra minutes. But typically, if you're late in class, you would surely be late in your first meeting. And going forward, this keeps on accentuating and you get to a point when people expect you to be casual in your approach to work. Because if you're late for meetings, you would naturally not be well prepared. That's an assumption that people make. Okay, so thereby you devalue yourself, you de-brand yourself. So the first thing is value people's time, be punctual. That really speaks a lot about your character, and that's the reason why somebody would respect you in an organization from day one, even if the others are not valuing time. There's a lot of companies where people come in late for meetings, and you get in and you say, okay, generally here people come 30 minutes late, so it's fine if I'm late too. I'll give you one interesting example. Do you all know about Indigo? Everybody? So what does Indigo stand for? On time, always, right? So one example of how they live their values and why Indigo is successful. So a very close friend of mine, they had gone in for, there was some CI or FICCI in some industry meet that was happening in their premises. So they just walked in and they were some 10 minutes late for the meeting, okay? So they went in and they were trying to get into the conference room. The guard who was standing, somebody just like you would, I'm sure, have some security guard who was standing outside the conference room. He just walks in, switches off the lights and says, sorry, you can't have your meeting. And these guys were shocked. They said, how can you say that? We are industry stalwarts. We've come from different organizations. How can you just ask us to leave? So the guard says, no, you were late. So everybody in the organization, from the lowest position to the senior most position, is empowered to take this call. If you are late, you cannot be entertained in the organization. So even the security guard has the guts to come and turn off the AC and the lights and say that you cannot have this meeting because I've been instructed to never allow any meeting to start late. Can you believe that? This is real because this is how Indigo operates, and that is the reason why you see it's so ingrained in them. from the flight attendants to the ground staff, everybody behaves this way, because across the organization, they walk the talk. So that's how these values get propagated. So punctuality. Another thing that, again, for some of you who already have worked in organizations, for those of you who haven't, people generally feel that there are certain skills like, you know, leadership, collaboration, there's certain skills that organizations expect you to come in with. But when somebody like me who comes into the campus and starts an interview, how would we gauge you on this? Because you're in a campus, right? You've been studying, you've been just attending classes. So how do I assess you on leadership skills? How do I assess you on collaboration and teamwork? There are, of course, a lot of good psychometric tests to do that. But typically, what is appreciated is if you participate in certain, there must be so many fairs, and I just saw some posters outside, right? So there's so many such activities that happen on campus. If you're a part of that, if you're part of, the placement committee of the campus, or you have worked on a part of the campus fest or something like that, that really goes a long way in building up your CV or your resume. Because that's when you can actually prove to the interviewer that, yes, I have some leadership skills, even though I'm just a student. And believe it or not, it is the most difficult thing to lead without titles. In organizations, it's not too difficult to lead because you have a designation. You have people who report to you. So they know that you do their appraisals. So, a lot of times, even if they hate you, they would have to say yes. But that's not so in campuses. When you're leading a team of peer group who have no expectations from you, they are not dependent on you. But in spite of that, they would have to listen to you and work with you. So that actually displays amazing leadership skills and collaboration skills. So that's something that is always looked at very favorably. So did you get the third point? Yeah, so I hope somebody is counting. The next one is staying up to date. And I don't think I need to say this too much to this generation, because you are 24/7, 365 days connected, wired. Yes or no? But I'm not talking about Facebook. I'm not talking of Tinder or Twitter. I'm mostly speaking about at least some of the, I know it's very outdated, but still, since you're in a B school, you should read the Economic Times. It may seem very boring, outdated, that how can you read a newspaper in today's date, but read the e-version, but be up to date, read the Economic Times. Because if you are not abreast with what's happening in the industry today on a regular basis, watching a lot of these television shows which are on business is not enough. You really need to either a Business Standard or an Economic Times online. Just be abreast of what's happening, because you don't know as on today which industry you're going to be walking into, right? So you need to understand how each of the industries work. That's really important. You need to also make sure that you have a problem-solving attitude. You don't necessarily all the time, maybe to your teachers, come in with a problem. Typically what is appreciated in organizations is when you come to your senior, you say, this is the problem on the table, and these are the three options that I have. Which one would you like to choose? Nobody likes to have a team member who every day comes in the morning and starts crying of what a problem there is and what to do. There's unemployment in the country, we know. There's poverty in India. We all understand that, but it's not enough to talk about. You need to actually come in with you don't have to solve such big problems, but at least the kind of problems that you bring to the table, you need to come in with a problem-solving attitude with the solutions and not simply with the problems, always. So that's something that people really don't like, crybabies, cribbing all the time. Like it or not, there's a huge amount of importance even today given to communication. So you may be amazing at your work. You may be the best possible person. You may be God's gift to mankind. But if you cannot articulate that to another person, that is of no use. If you are not able to brand yourself well, that's actually of no use. There are a lot of people in the industry who are extremely good at what they do, but because they are not able to present it, they do not get their dues. Okay, so it may sound very cliched, but it actually works. You really need to be able to be good at written as well as verbal communication. That's the key. And if you feel at any point that you are not able to get to that point, this is your arena, this is your space. I'm sure the Institute will allow you a lot of chances of public speaking, a lot of opportunities will be provided to you. Please grab those and please develop this. If you do not, especially coming from a B-school background, you are not going to be very successful. Yeah, because this is not a mere technology specialization that you just, even if you're in systems, you know, you're not going to be sitting in a room and just doing coding. You're actually going to go out there and work with large teams. So that's really important. I don't want to really spend too much time in just giving gyan, but again, something your parents, I'm sure, would have told you again and again, nothing pays like hard work. You know, that's all I would like to end by saying, that this is, there's no grand way to success. You have to put in your sweat and blood. You need to work very hard, starting today. Be it your academics, be it any organization you're working in, you really, really need to work very hard. Because a lot of people will tell you that, you know, you just need to work smart, you just need to be, you know, street smart, and that's how you get away. You get away for a short while, but not for too long. In order to be successful and sustainable going forward, you actually have to put in a lot of hours, you know, waking hours. Because I don't know whether you guys are really abreast with what's happening in the industry, but are you aware that, again, this is not a Christopher Nolan film. Huh? It's actually a fact that bots on a daily basis are replacing human roles. Are you aware of that? Yeah, not robots, bots, which are nothing but computer programs. So today, and it's a reality. This is not, again, something that, you know, a sci-fi exotic article somebody wrote in some newspaper. This is actually a fact. If you know Infosys, for example, Vishal Sikka keeps saying this all the time, that one employee will be performing one job at a time, and the second time it will be taken over by the bot, because we don't need unnecessarily human beings to be wasted to just be doing repetitive work. Okay, so all repetitive work, which all this while was happening, and this is not IT, this is across all industries, it's across FMCG, this is across financial services, this is across IT, ITES, across all sorts of organizations, all non-value add repetitive activities are being taken over by the bots. By the time you guys get into the mainstream corporate, you know, these days on a monthly basis, the technology changes. There's going to be a time when very, very soon, in the nearest near future, not too long from now, that only high value jobs will be available for us humans. Everything else will be taken over. Again, I'm saying it's a reality. It's working beautifully in organizations up to a decision level of 4 to 5. Artificial intelligence has taken over. And there are companies where it's being used. You understand how a decision tree works? Yes? No? Yeah, so, and you know, human beings are always better than systems, because we can take decisions, right? We can think on our feet. If you suddenly say that, I don't want to hear you anymore, you know, I don't want to listen to what you're saying, but I would like to hear something about the pharma industry, for example. Now, a bot may not be immediately able to move to that, but a human being, because a human being is a thinking being, can quickly move to another topic, which may be not prepared at this point in time. But artificial intelligence is making this possible, that up to 4 decision points, the bots can move. So if you say no, then okay, then what, then what, then what? So at least 4 to 5 has already happened. Going forward, you do understand what's going to happen to all of us, right? Unless we move to the next level, unless we bring in that much of value on the table. Just coming in and doing a 9-to-5 job, which is extremely repetitive and tactical, is not going to take us very far. So I guess I've spoken enough, and I already see a lot of bored faces. So, So this is broadly what I wanted to speak about. This may seem very generic, very cliched, but all of this is, believe it or not, actually lived by me and has been learned the hard way. I wish somebody had told me long back that these are the things you should look at. But there's no rocket science in it. It's really simple. But you need to also ensure that all your careers are in your hands. Don't expect going forward, because you're going to enter the corporate world, that suddenly, you know, somebody will get a godfather who's going to come in and hold your hand and is going to take you somewhere, or your parents are going to go ahead and help you. It's not going to happen going forward. You're completely on your own. You are the only ones who have to make it happen. And your world is in your hands. Your sky is your sky. You know, as people say, sky is your limit, but your sky, you know, not anybody else's sky. So that's broadly what I had to say, but if you have any questions. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am. This is Jyoti Shukla. Ma'am, you said that the third point is leadership, right? Okay. We all wanted to be a good leader, but there should be a good follower also, right? So how to be on a backseat when you know the driving?
Thank you, Jyoti. That's actually a great question, because today there is a lot of work that's happening around followership. That's not merely about leadership, it's about followership. So when I spoke of leadership skills, if you remember, I also spoke of collaboration. So when you're on campus and when like, how you can work towards creating a great event, for example, or working on a particular project. Sometimes you're the leader who's leading, who's again leading without titles. At times you're also collaborating as a team member. You're absolutely right. It's equally important to step back and also give space to somebody who maybe knows a bit better than you at that particular area. If you don't do that, as a team you would fail. You know, so typically, this is too early for you. Maybe after a while, once you get into your deeper understanding of human behavior or the way the corporate world works, you'll understand that the higher you go, your expertise reduces. It's just your people management capability that will take you far. So there comes a point in time when you would have all your team members. They know much, much more than you do about your job, because they are experts in their field. You need to step back and make sure that the right person is chosen for the right job, and you're able to make sure that that person is successful. Have you heard about Warren Buffett?
Yeah.
Yes? So you know what he does, right? I think these are folklores today, that in the beginning of every financial year, he sits and writes out a handwritten note to all his CEOs, and he says that for the next 12 months, he doesn't interact with them at all in any way. He says, I've just chosen the right set of people and they'll be doing their job. I don't need to make their lives miserable by breathing down their backs. So that's all that he does.
Good evening, ma'am. Here in the balcony center.
Okay. Yeah.
Ma'am, I'm Pravesh Jain.
See, now a guy is asking a question.
See, in bigger organizations, yeah, the performance of juniors get overshadowed by managers. Mm-hmm. How to sustain that?
Okay, interesting. So it's not in large organizations, it's in all organizations. But that was just a joke. What you just mentioned was a fact in the past. I agree. There was a time when people would steal credit, because if there is a scope to put forward your idea, typically the manager would go and put forward that idea and the junior would not be able to. But today, almost every organization has an online mechanism, a real-time mechanism of capturing ideas, real-time mechanism of performance management system, which are generally always a system thing. So all your KRAs, your special achievements, everything is generally documented in a system and passed on, not only to the manager, but to the reviewer as well as to HR. So this, and most organizations today are matrix organizations. So there are multiple people who are always watching you. There are lots of cross-functional teams, lot of forums in which people seek visibility and they recognize people because of the visibility that they bring, right? So in today's date, it's very difficult to actually overshadow a high-performing junior. It used to be in the past, but today those walls have been broken down because of technology. So a lot of technological support.
Hello, good evening, ma'am.
Sorry,
ma'am,
are you?
At your left.
Ma'am,
my name is Rashi Garg. Ma'am, I want to ask that nowadays a lot of importance is given to emotional quotient as well with IQ. So HR being a field where we have to deal with people. So to be employable, is it that HR needs more EQ, like emotional quotient, than intelligence quotient?
Okay, great question. But let me break your myth. You know, this is something that I'm sure a lot of people will brainwash you on, that HR is only touchy-feely soft jobs, you know. HR is all about being nice and sweet to people and saying yes to whatever people ask you for. But again, a lot of things, there's been a huge paradigm shift. You know, things have changed in the last few years. Today, most HR leaders are supposed to be extremely good in analytics, in predictive indicators. Those days, again, are far behind us when just by, you know, giving a very descriptive, generic answer, in a senior leadership meeting, when somebody asks an HR leader today that what is the state of talent today in the organization? Where are we, you know, in terms of talent? In the earlier days, some HR leader would stand up and say, oh, we are building talent, we are buying talent, we are borrowing talent, there's a lot of work happening around talent management, we have a great talent pipeline, you know, blah, 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 you know, a lot of very interesting jargons. Today's date, an HR leader is supposed to stand up and say, this is the percentage of my talent which I've sourced from within. So 33% of my talent is getting infilled. 33% is getting backfilled. There is so much percentage which I have borrowed from somewhere, some percentage which I have gotten from the market. You know, this is what I've bought. This is how ready, in terms of state of readiness, my talent is to take up future positions, succession planning. So most of it, and this is a percentage of talent which are at high risk. Right? So there's a lot of data today that's getting worked on. And of course, EQ is very, very important, but it is not merely important for HR. It is very important for all of any business leader tomorrow, you know, be it in marketing or in finance or systems, whichever branch you're from, it is important. But do not ignore numbers. You know what people used to say, you get into HR because you're not good with numbers. Maths may weak hogi, you know, that's typically what people say. Please do not ignore your numbers. Be very good with analytics today. EQ is not enough.
Yeah, hello, good evening, ma'am. I'm on your right.
On my right.
On your right, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, as you told that all the repeated works are going to be done by the bots, then why we are digging our own grave, since everyone can't be a decision maker?
Okay. Now, this is a very difficult question, you know, because this is more to do with social equity, because of course there's a large population who believe that this is not right, we should not be doing this, because this is inequitable growth. By this you make the rich richer and the poor poorer and all of that. But believe it or not, if you look at it from the other side, today's date, if you go to any and again, some of you have worked in companies where I'm sure you've been asked to do repetitive tasks. The second time that you're told to do that, you yourself will get irritated. You know, you would say, come on, this is a simple job. I'm supposed to look at a data sheet. I'm supposed to pick up that data, put it in an Excel format. Then I'm supposed to run some programs on it and make a presentation out of it. Yes or no? Most of you will be doing this, right? Collating data and making a presentation, that's something which all management people do, right? So, second time, third time, believe me, you will get sick of it. So a time has come today when the human brain is so evolved that nobody wants to do these repetitive tasks also. In organization, people after a while refuse. They say, what next? What do I get? Which is my next role? I don't want to keep doing this. Even freshers don't want to do it. So there's a lot of tedious, mundane work which is getting moved out, and more value-added evolved work is coming in.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
My name is Vipin.
Hi.
Since you're from HR, I would like to know that how HR people grow in their career. Is it by being loyal to their company, or they also have to switch their companies? Because if I see in operations or in finance or even in marketing, they I mean, after all, everyone's on higher salaries and everything, so they have to switch companies. I want to know what's the case in HR.
Okay. Why do you think an HR person would be any different? So, end of the day, it's all the same. It would not be really different. But jokes aside, it is not merely because of growth or money that a person necessarily switches organization. I will give you my personal example. Why did I switch? So I started off my career with Tata Motors. I moved to multiple locations. I was learning and growing a lot. Beyond a point, I realized that if I keep growing like this in the HR field, because I didn't want to move from the function, I didn't want to get into another function, what else do I need to beef up my CV? Okay, so I needed cross-cultural experience. I needed experience of different cultures, of different geographies. I also needed some exposure into another industry because I had only worked in the automobile industry by then, right? So it was not necessarily because of money or because of promotion that somebody moves. You also need sometimes to make sure that at the end of the day, if you want to reach a particular level, you need to make sure that everything is checked in your profile. Right, you have exposure to everything. A success profile looks successful only when all the boxes are checked. It's not just the number of years of experience, it's what you've done in that period. Do you have enough exposure to various fields before you get to a particular level? Else you can stick in one company, and you can also in large companies get all of these. Today if I would have been in Tata Motors, it is a very large multinational today. Maybe I would have got it. But I would have had to lose another 10 years. I hope I've answered.
Hello. Hello, ma'am. On your left.
Ma'am, this is really interesting.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
Ma'am, my name is Madhur. Ma'am, I want to ask a question that people are becoming only salary-centric these days. Uh-huh. So they hesitate to take responsibilities more in their job. So being an HR, how do you deal with these kind of complaints?
Okay, so you're speaking just like all my business leaders. And it's very interesting that it's coming from students because this is what I get to hear all the time. People are not staying back because they want more money. It is just they want better smartphones and bigger cars, and that's the reason why people are moving. But I'm sure if you again go back and Google, you'll find that the top reason why a person moves is not necessarily because of money. Mostly, money is one of the hygiene factors, of course. It comes automatically. If you move an organization, you're not going to go by the same salary, right? You would obviously go with a higher salary, but that's just incidental. But people, if you check the top three boxes, you'll find it's always for career opportunities. People move because they want to do newer things. Like your friend just asked, it's beyond a point, it's boring to keep doing the same stuff. So especially your generation, you get bored very easily. And then you feel that this is enough. I want to go to another organization, do and learn more. So that's primarily one of the reasons why people move. Therefore, it is a huge challenge with each one of us, people like us, to keep on engaging people and to keep on giving them newer challenges so that they don't easily get bored by doing mundane tasks. So that's the challenge today which we are trying to fight.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes, you're to my right or left.
Ma'am, in front of you.
Okay.
Ma'am, actually I want to ask question regarding the rise in the share price of Lupin.
Right.
So ma'am, after 2008, the share price was 122 rupees of Lupin. It raised to 876 rupees in 2013, I guess. And after that, today the share price is 1146 rupees. So is it directly related to the sales of Lupin? And was there a suddenly increase in the sales of Lupin? I want to just ask you.
So this is one question which even the financial analysts are not able to answer, because just for your information, Lupin shares grew 7 times in 7 years. Okay, and just a year, 8 months back, it had crossed 2,000. It was 2,300. Today it's 1,300. Okay, so it was like a roller coaster ride, went up and came down. See, share prices to a large extent is market perception. It's speculation. Okay. Of course, it is built on a lot of fundamentals of the company. There are financial analysts who come and study the organizations, and based on the fundamentals, it reaches a particular level. But beyond that, there's a lot of market speculation. So why did the share prices fall? Because nothing has changed in the company. It's exactly the same company last 8 months, 9 months. Nothing has changed in any way. All the news has been positive news. Even like this is the sixth year that we are a great place to work. Every year we've been a great place to work. We are Asia's 15th great places to work. We won best employers in Asia. CNBC awards, you know, anything, just name it and Forbes list, we are there. But I think all of you by now know, you know, we can blame it all on Trump.
Yes.
So in the recent past, because of all the changes that has happened in economy, the way the American economy has changed, the way Trump has come in. So can I take 2 minutes to give you a little bit of pharma gyan?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah?
Okay. So I don't know whether you are abreast with this, what's happening in the pharma industry today. As you would understand, India, China, we are primarily generic markets, right? We are into generic medicines. Now, when you talk of generic medicines, it's one thing to say that we are copying, you know, you're just copying one from the other because the innovator is different, and then you pick up an innovator drug and you just tweak it a little bit and you create your own product. But the generic market actually, the generic companies actually bring down the prices of drugs, right? So all the innovator companies, the big pharma as we call them, they are all American companies mostly. They are all in America and they earn a lot of margins. The moment the generic companies come in, their margins start getting diluted. That makes them uncomfortable, because of which there's a huge amount of lobbying that's happening today in the US, wherein the US FDA, all our plants, by the way, are US FDA accredited. 88% of all that we research on and produce is for advanced markets. It's mostly for the US, because that's where the high margins are. Now, what is happening today is, because of this extreme amount of lobbying, the US FDA all the time are like sniffer dogs coming and checking out you know, all the generic companies. If you would read the newspaper, you'd find that lots of Indian companies have recently got 483s. 483s are like non-compliances, that something is wrong in your factory. Nobody actually reads through what is wrong. People just say, oh my God, you know, Indians, they must be doing some hera-feri, they're not very good with data. See what happened to Ranbaxy. So these kind of stories do the round, by which the confidence of the consumers fall, or the doctors fall, and therefore the innovator company goes up. You know, this is a pretty common tactic which everybody today is aware of. As I speak today, three of our plants are parallelly getting audited. Today in the morning, around 8:39, two US FDA inspectors walked into our Goa plant and started to audit. You know, it's no longer pre-informed. It's just they just walk in and they start auditing. So there has been a huge amount of pressure on India and China, on all the generic companies, because of the onslaught of the US lobbying that's happening, right? So there's a lot that's happening in the economy. It's more to do with economics and less to do with the fundamentals of the company. Sorry for the diversion.
Good evening, ma'am. Ma'am Rameshwari here. Ma'am, you mentioned never say no. Ma'am, I know there's nothing bad of doing something you don't want, but ma'am, doing it again and again, won't they take us grandly? Like, I'm the person who can't say no. So ma'am, how to do?
Right, so when I say don't say no is when you're being given opportunity. So when you join a company, initially, or even when you're summer interning, you know, it may not be a permanent job also, it may just be an internship. In my career, I've seen a lot of interns who worked under me. I'm just taking the simplest example of interns, you know. So say there are four interns, two of them, the moment it's like 5 o'clock, they would pack up their bags and they would leave. Two of them, if suppose it's a high pressure period of some kind, some work is happening in the department, would stay back and ask, what are you trying to do? Okay, it's assessment happening, performance management happening. Can I help? What can I do? So when you have a lot of pressure, then you would like to tell the interns, you know, do something, take these forms and, you know, try and see what you can make out of it, make an Excel sheet out of it, do some work on it. By doing this, the amount of exposure that they are getting is not something the two interns who left at 5 would get ever. You know, they would have to join the company, work for 2 years to actually get that kind of exposure. So what I meant is that if you keep saying no to maybe, you know, mundane work like this, which apparently may appear mundane, you would lose opportunities to learn. Because not necessarily when you join as a fresher, you will be made in charge of a department. You would actually have to learn from the base and grow up, right? So if you don't do the work at the base, as I'm sure some of you would know, in the army, you have to dig trenches first. Every officer in the army first digs trenches, you know, then only they are allowed to become officers. Because they say, once you know how to dig trenches, you're not going to tell a soldier that in the next 24 hours, I want an 8 feet deep trench and, you know, maybe 16 feet wide trench to be dug. Because you know it's not possible, right? So that's the reason why it's like digging trenches. You need to do some mundane work to start with, to learn and grow. It's not forever.
Hello, ma'am. A very good evening to you.
Where are you? Okay, yes.
My name is Shamim. My question to you is it only a HR professional who is preferable for a training and development role? If not, then could you please throw some light on it?
Okay, so today it's more of learning and development. And again, like I'm saying, things are changing so fast that it's very difficult for all of us also to keep pace. You'll be surprised to know that a lot of learning and development experts are being moved off, and the people who are taking their roles are the gaming experts, right? Because day-to-day learning through books and through systems are really out. Today, it's all about gamification. So there's a lot of IT professionals who are good in this. They are getting into it. And then they're taking help from other subject matter experts. Now, the subject matter expert doesn't necessarily have to be a behavioral expert, right? If you're in a financial services company, you're in an insurance company, the subject matter expert is somebody who's an expert in actuarial, say, suppose. So you get a subject matter expert and you get a techie, and they together can make an amazing gamification platform, which is the best way to learn for your generation. You know, nobody wants to sit like this and listen to someone and say, what the hell, you know, what does she know? Right, so that is the reason why in the past, I agree, it used to be very HR driven, very soft skills driven, but those days are gradually going off because there's a lot of blended learning that's coming in today.
Thank you, ma'am.